Good evening and welcome to our nightly telecast of Just the News. I'm Faye D'Souza. Every night we give you a wrap of all of the important information that has taken place across the country. Information that you need to know, which is different from information that might be exciting or entertaining or information that you might want to know. The job of news is to tell you what is important, is to tell you what you need to know now. This is what we're going to do here on Just the News. Let's get straight to it. The Supreme Court has observed today that pulling up government officials in contempt of court for not following court orders will not solve Delhi's oxygen crisis. This comes after the Delhi High Court issued a show cause notice to the central government for not following a Supreme Court order which instructed the central government to provide adequate oxygen to the city of Delhi. Now, the central government went to Supreme Court to appeal against the show cause notice of the High Court, which basically pulled up the central government for not following the Supreme Court's order. It was slightly convoluted, but basically the Supreme Court said this: ultimately, putting officers in jail or hauling up officers for contempt will not bring oxygen. Please take steps to solve this, said Justice Chandrachud today. The Supreme Court had asked the central government to provide Delhi with at least 700 MT of oxygen as of the 3rd of May. But that order was not followed as Delhi continues to get a lower allocation of oxygen. The Supreme Court today has told the central government to submit a plan to the court by 10:30 tomorrow morning on how this allocation is going to be fulfilled. The Supreme Court also suggested that the central government and the Delhi government consult with Mumbai's Municipal Commissioner Iqbal Singh Chahal to find out how Mumbai has managed to control the problem in the city and manage their oxygen resources as well, and said there might be something there for Delhi to learn from. It was also at this point that Justice Chandrachud pointed out to the Additional Solicitor General Chetan Sharma, who had gone to Delhi High Court and said that there was no commitment to provide oxygen to Delhi. In Allahabad High Court, the High Court has observed today that COVID deaths due to the shortage of oxygen is nothing short of genocide. It also said that there are several viral videos where people can be seen begging for oxygen cylinders and the administrators and the police are indifferent to their pleas. The Allahabad High Court said, and I quote, "We find these news items showing a contrary picture to the one claimed by the government of the state and that there was sufficient supply of oxygen." The court also observed that we are at pain in observing the death of COVID patients for the non-supply of oxygen to hospitals. This is a criminal act and it's not less than genocide by those who've been entrusted with the task to ensure continuous supply of oxygen. The court has directed the government to take immediate remedial measures and has ordered an inquiry into the incidents at Meerut and Lucknow where patients allegedly passed away due to the shortage of oxygen. The central government's scientific advisor, Dr. K. Vijay Raghavan, has said that a third wave of COVID-19 in India is inevitable. He also said vaccines will need to be updated to deal with the new strains that might be developing in the country. And he said, given the high levels at which the virus is circulating across the country, it's not clear at what time scale this phase 3 will occur. Hopefully, incrementally, but we should prepare for new waves. Ongoing surveillance is needed so that vaccines are upgraded, obviously, to meet any sort of new strains or mutation. As of the last 24 hours, India reported 3.82 lakh COVID cases, 3,780 deaths, the highest in the last 24 hours. Some worrying numbers are coming out of the state of Karnataka right now. Karnataka has now, for the first time, reported more than 50,000 cases in one day. The state has reported 50,112 cases in one day, and the city of Bengaluru has reported 23,106 cases. Also, at a time when Bangalore is now facing a shortage of beds and facing a shortage of supplies as well, it seems that BJP MP Tejaswi Surya has alleged that there is a massive corruption scam taking place in the allocation of hospital beds in the city of Bangalore. He said that there is an artificial shortage because of widespread corruption. He said that this is an unholy nexus of the BBMP or the Bruhat Bengaluru Mahanagara Palike, which is the corporation, officers, the Arogya Mitras who are supposed to be helping people, and certain private agents that have led to this scam. Basically, he also said in a press conference he addressed today that there was a sting operation conducted by the police in the city where the police approached the accused for beds in hospitals, and the accused quoted 20,000 and 40,000 rupees for beds. The police have now arrested one social worker and her nephew for the role. Speaking to the Indian Express, the Deputy Commissioner of Police South, Harish Pandey, has said the accused were circulating WhatsApp messages offering to help patients find beds, but when they were contacted, they would ask for a lot of money. He also said that they might have had contacts within the BBMP war room, which is allocating the beds, which is how such deals on bed allotments was being done. A case has now been handed over to the Central Crime Branch for a deeper investigation. The Indian Council for Medical Research, or the ICMR, has now revised its guidelines on testing and the number of RT-PCR tests we conduct across the country in order to take the load off laboratories that are currently inundated with the number of tests that they're having to conduct. Now, the ICMR has recommended no RT-PCR tests at the time of hospital discharge if the person is asymptomatic and has spent a certain number of days in hospital. Also, they've said a healthy individual who's traveling domestically, whether by train or by car or by flight, needn't take an RT-PCR test when crossing into different states. Now remember, many states had asked for a negative RT-PCR test when coming into the state, but the ICMR has now recommended that this can be removed altogether in order to reduce the load on laboratories. It also said that if you have tested positive from an antigen test, or if you've tested positive once from an RT-PCR test, or you've completed 10 days of home isolation, there is no need for you to take a new test, thereby bringing down the load on the tests right now. The ICMR has also made it mandatory to enter information on vaccination status while taking the test so that the government can now have data on the number of people who've been vaccinated and who have then tested positive so these people can be tracked. This is finally a good move. The members of a small delegation accompanying External Affairs Minister S. Jaishankar to the UK have tested positive for COVID. The minister has now decided to conduct all his engagements via virtual mode in order to be careful. He said today on Twitter, was made aware yesterday evening of exposure to possible COVID cases. As a measure of abundant caution and also out of consideration for others, I've decided to conduct my engagements on virtual mode. That will be the case for the G7 meeting today as well. Before I read out the next story, a disclaimer that our audience might find some of these details distressing. 5 COVID patients passed away today at a private hospital in Uttarakhand's Roorkee due to the shortage of oxygen. According to reports, the oxygen facility in the hospital was disrupted for around 30 minutes. One of the patients who died was on ventilator support and 4 others were on oxygenated beds. The magisterial probe has now been ordered into the incident. The Haridwar district magistrate has said a medical audit into the hospital is also being conducted. Let's take a look at restrictions announced by some states now. West Bengal has announced restrictions across the state. Shops will be open from 7 to 10 in the morning and 5 to 7 in the evening. Local trains are suspended. Social and political gatherings have been banned. West Bengal recorded its highest single day spike of 17,639 cases on Tuesday. Uttar Pradesh has extended its partial COVID curfew for 4 more days until the 10th of May. Only essential services will be allowed. Uttar Pradesh reported more than 25,000 cases in the last 24 hours. Goa, which had initially imposed a 4-day lockdown, has now extended restrictions until the 10th of May. Goa Chief Minister has said additional restrictions will be imposed on shops selling non-essential items and restaurants will be closed except for home delivery. In other news away from COVID, a 5-judge constitutional bench of the Supreme Court has struck down the special Maratha reservation that was brought in by the Maharashtra government back in 2019. The court basically said that since this new reservation, which was for 16% both in public education and in employment, took the total reservation well beyond the 50% ceiling, it was no longer tenable. The court said it didn't make out any exceptional circumstance in which to exceed the ceiling limit of 50%. The judgment was delivered by the Constitutional Bench of Justices Ashok Bhushan, Nageshwar Rao, Abdul Nazir, Hemant Gupta and Ravindra Bhatt. Now, this was a 2018 act called the Maharashtra State Reservation for Socially and Educationally Backward Classes. It was amended in 2019 and it brought in a 16% reservation for the Maratha community in educational institutions and government employment. The act was challenged in the Bombay High Court because it took the total reservation up to 68% in the state of Maharashtra. The Bombay High Court upheld this new reservation, but when it was taken to Supreme Court then referred it to a constitutional bench, and the constitutional bench have decided now not to to actually throw it out. Effectively, it has been struck down. Now, we told you yesterday about a letter that the Pilots Union of the Indian Commercial Pilots Association had written to the government saying that pilots would stop working if they're not vaccinated immediately. Air India has now responded saying it will vaccinate all of its employees by the end of May. The airline has said that in the last few days it has lost several valued employees to the second wave of COVID, and it's announced compensation of 10 lakh rupees for the families of its employees who were lost. In the letter, the pilots' body basically said that they've been working non-stop and they were the first to get the pay cut, but the last to be considered for vaccinations. Moving on now to news coming in from the world of business. The RBI on Wednesday announced a COVID-19 package worth 50,000 crore rupees. Now, this is how it will work. The RBI has opened up another round of restructuring for loans that individuals and small borrowers have taken for up to 2 years. The RBI Governor Shaktikanta Das has said loans which were given until March 31st, 2022 by banks will be classified as priority sector loans for 3 years or its repayment, whichever is earlier. And this classification will come with a better interest rate. Banks who do this better interest rate and a couple of other things that the RBI has announced will get a special offer on what they're calling now the COVID loan book, which means they will get a higher rate from the RBI if they keep the same amount of money with the RBI, and the interest they get from that money will be higher. Individuals and small businesses that have borrowed less than 25 lakh rupees can ask banks to restructure the payment of their loans for 2 years. Looking now at news coming in from around the world, Pfizer is likely to seek the US FDA, the Food and Drug Administration, permission to administer its COVID vaccine to children between the ages of 2 and 11 in September this year. Meanwhile, the vaccine study on children between the ages of 6 months to 11 is already going on. Moderna has started similar studies as well. Former US police officer who was convicted for murdering George Floyd, Derek Chauvin, is now seeking a new trial. Chauvin's attorney, Eric Nielsen, said his client was deprived of a fair trial when last month he was found guilty of second and third degree murder and manslaughter in Floyd's killing. The Black Lives Matter protest was erupted and spread across the world after the killing of George Floyd. An update right now from the world of sports. Israel Sapir Berman has become the first transgender referee to officiate a football match in Israel's Premier League. Berman publicly announced her transition on Tuesday, saying she had always seen herself as female even at a young age. She told reporters that players had already started using the feminine form of words in Hebrew when addressing her. British football referee Lucy Clark became the first transgender referee in football in the world back in 2018. Now, one piece of positive news that we will leave you with, a pilot project that's being worked on right now in IIT Bombay has successfully tested converting a pressure swing absorption nitrogen unit to a PSA oxygen unit. So basically what this means is that they found a way to turn a nitrogen plant into an oxygen generator. It produced oxygen which was 93 to 96% pure, which means it can be used in hospitals for COVID patients. I'm going to leave you there. A couple of notes. Remember, tell other people about this news bulletin if you think it's something that's worth sharing. The source articles of all of the information is at the bottom of our YouTube descriptions. You can take a look at that if you want to. And stay safe and stay at home. Thanks for watching.